It's a 10:23. Let's get Jesus on the line. Yep, it's a 10:23. It's an emergency. It's an emergency, folks. We're in an emergency status now. Global mental health alert. So I'm under strict orders at this point. Standby status. So restrictions. It's like the National Guard Reserve. Everything's normal. You live your normal life, and then when there's a crisis, you get called up or you put on alert. So I've been put on alert. I'm part of the emergency global mental health emergency response team, which is designed to cool down mental agitation. Now, it's a very interesting situation. At this point, I got to listen to my boss. Longchenpa is my boss. And he says, you know, you're going to have to, some things we don't want you to do. You're on standby status right now. And you got to really prepare, you know, be mentally focused on what the boss's orders are. That how you're deployed is not up to you. You see, it's up to the boss. Yeah, and so the whole thing rests on trusting the boss. In the military, you're trained to take orders, whether you like it or orders or not. Here, it's a similar parallel, in that it's your own volition. You're still free, but you have to trust that the boss knows how to deploy you properly and not pepper the boss, like question everything. You know, the boss says, this, you know, this is how you deploy. Okay, I'll do my best. Thank you. I know you put me in the right place to succeed and to be helpful. So it's based on trust, but a positive, reasonable trust, not a robotic, if you don't trust, you're being court-martialed or something. Well, if you go against the boss's orders and deployments and refuse to do this and freelance, then you won't be part of the team, and you'd be like an outcast. But you outcast yourself, and then you don't fit in anywhere, because you don't certainly don't fit in with those who are stirring up the mental agitation. So certainly you don't want to be an outcast. So I'm adhering to the advice. Adhering to the advice at this time. But I could still say a lot. It's just, and then some stuff is classified on need-to-know basis. That, you know, that, like, for instance, the deployment decisions are not something I know about. For obvious reasons. It's like, like in a time of war, or a time of crisis, we might say, the opposition wants to know what your deployment plans are so they can counteract them. So obviously, the higher-ups guard those deployment plans. They don't give them out until it's safe, you know, the right time to give them out. Otherwise, people like me might blab them out, and those who are working for the other side, which is most of the world, actually, will, you know, use that to counteract. So I don't know how I will be deployed. I don't know how anyone else is going to be deployed at all. That's not my job to inquire into deployment strategy, okay? That's not my job. So, nothing I can say about that, really. But I understand the basic outline of the purpose of it all. We can speak about that. Is to my job, the job of my team, that I'm part of a team, mental health emergency response team, global mental health emergency response team, is to cool the agitation of the world. Cool down the agitation. Mental agitation. Because when mental agitation gets too hot, we lose the ability to reason properly and make progress on the spiritual path. And then we really backslide. It's very bad. So when we cool our minds down, less agitation, then we're able to begin to consider, entertain, and pr- properly entertain, meaning to host truth. We say, truth, I want to spend some time listening to you today. And you do it. And this is the way. This is the way. Is you give hospitality to truth. When our minds are super agitated, we don't give hospitality to truth anymore. So that's a very bad situation. So the emergency that is in front of us, the crisis, is this severe mental agitation. And we have to do everything we can do to cool it down as much as possible. Everyone should work to cool it down instead of fanning the flames. Now, why do we have this mental agitation in the world? Because we believe that we're trying to modify ourselves. We're trying to modify reality. And we believe that by producing despair, we can modify reality. In other words, we're saying we have no way back to reality, therefore that modifies reality. We think we're separate from reality with no way back. And then this causes such despair that it actually changes reality in some way. Now, I found out for 100% sure that this doesn't work at all. No possibility of this ever working. So that tilted everything for me towards truth, to be hospitable to truth. But there are many, most in the world have not experienced, don't know this. They don't have a conviction like I do. So they're ambivalent about it at best. But many are still gung-ho about that, yeah, we can do it. We can do it. We can modify reality. And so they're trying intentionally to produce this mental agitation, heat up the mind, like a fire in the mind. The mind just gets so agitated and fiery and angry, lashing out, paranoid, projecting, attacking, scheming to the downfall of others and all this stuff. It's terrible. This is what the world is into. It's mental agitation. And in that mindset, you cannot be hospitable to truth. You shift over to the left side of the brain, so to speak. The left side means the leaving side, the belief that we can leave reality. Whereas the right side says, no, we're right in being hospitable to truth because we can't leave reality. Keep in mind that which can never work, in other words, modifying what reality, was doomed from the very start. There was never any, at any point, was there any hope that it would work? None. It was doomed from the start. And this is what we have a difficult time recognizing. And we have to gradually be hospitable to this and get used to it. Truth is true and lies were never true, can never be true. At no point was there any possibility of the impossible happening. Never. So, doomed from the beginning. This is difficult for most to accept. Now, so how do we be hospitable to truth? In order to calm down our minds, we have to be hospitable to truth. And we have to understand that being hospitable to truth will create a temporary agitation in us. And what we must do is we must be patient with this temporary agitation. It's a lack of familiarity. And trust that it will calm down. And don't struggle with it. This is how we are able to entertain truth. Okay, so there is a way. There is a way. This is the practice that I'm showcasing in the world here. There absolutely is a way to be hospitable to truth. But most of us sabotage this. Almost everyone in the world are self-saboteurs. They sabotage their hospitality to truth. That's sabotaged. They very quickly are constantly alert to not allow this to take place because they're trying to succeed at modifying themselves. They think that's the only hope they have. Why do we feel this way? It's the only hope we have. Because we've been at it for so long. A great way to look at this world and everything is that spirit is simply pretending to channel nothing. You know, channelers like channeling Jesus, channeling, you know, this and that. There's been a lot of channeling over the last 50 years. Channeling divine truth, channeling the Seth material, channeling Ramtha, channeling Jesus Christ, channeling... It goes on and on and on. There's maybe just thousands and thousands and thousands channeling this. It means being hospitable to this perspective. Being hospitable to a certain perspective is what channeling is. Now, what Spirit has done is we decided as just a sort of a real giddy laugher, you know, like let's channel nothing. And it was this game that we started that says channeling nothing. And it was sort of a game of creativity. How creative can we be to pretend that that nothing actually has something to say? And that we're channeling nothing. So we're like channelers for nothing. This is the situation, really. It was started out as this silly game. And it became wildly popular. Because it seemed to offer this a very different way to use our creativity. So like a Pokemon Go game, you know, someone streams up a game and everybody, you know, says, oh, that's a different way to use my creativity. This is really interesting to me. And so, you know, they start getting into that. It's just all make-believe. It's very silly, okay? So this game was started in reality of channeling nothing, transmissions from nothing. So what is nothing transmitting to us? What kind of truth can nothing transmit to us? Or what can it transmit to us? And so we began to imagine what nothing might transmit. But of course, it's all completely make-believe. There's no transmissions from nothing at all. So each one of us are playing this game of transmitting nothing. And collectively, we've built up this collective sort of body of channeling work from nothing, which we see as this world, the universe, energy, existence, all of this. This is what we think nothing has channeled. We think nothing has channeled this world and channeled nature to us and channeled this. And we're like, wow, nothing is so profound. And it's really just a game of our own imagination, what we're pretending. A silly game. But it intrigued us. Again, it seemed to give us a different usage for our creativity. So we're all expert channelers of nothing. This is actually very much what has happened. And so what is the bottom line of this? Okay, if we can just be hospitable to truth here and do your wow practicing, stay in your right-mindedness and just say to the left-mindedness, okay, I know that you're a little agitated. Not quite yet. Not quite yet. I'm still listening. Not quite yet. Just put it off for a while. Put it off. And then you'll deal with the agitation a little later. So you have to off-put the agitation for a while in order to listen, and then you say, then deal with it later. This is how you have to do it, because the agitation will arise, and you just have to say, I'm still listening, I'm still listening, I'm still listening, and then at some point, okay, wow, I'll just accept, you know, the backlash at this point. And if you're willing to consciously do that, you will find that the backlash smooths out and dissipates gently. And you feel sort of like that you're working with yourself in the right way. You're not sabotaging yourself anymore. But so you do pay a price to being hospitable to truth. You do pay a price still. But you consciously decide to pay this price. So I know I'll pay a price for giving this information out. So I just have to be patient and let the wow reverberate. You know, the back looks like, wow. How you can't say that, but you said it. Oh my gosh, what's going to happen? Oh, that's great that you said it, but it's not so great. Oh, it's, you know, it's just all this kind of agitation of uncertainty. So in order to be hospitable to the truth, we have to put that off for a little while. We say, okay, I'm committed to allowing that backlash to be experienced, but not quite yet. I'm spending some time actually being hospitable to the truth here. Okay, that's the whole secret to it. It's the entire secret to your success. You're willing to pay the price, but but you don't allow agitation to interrupt, which it will do if you don't put it off. In fact, most people spend their entire lives never being hospitable to truth for even an instant. Constantly allowing the self-sabotage to take place. Interruption, question, concretize, wait a minute, hold on. Can't get anywhere that way. Just spin your wheels. So you have to give a sustained, smooth time to truth, to allow it to present itself to you. Knowing that your agitation will arise at some point, you have to experience it and allow it to calm down. Because part of you is like, I don't like this, I don't like this, I don't like this. And say, yeah, I know you don't like it. And I'm going to be very upset. Yeah, I know you'll be very upset. So I'll experience that upset a little bit later. Pouting, temper tantrum, like, I don't want you to listen to this. Okay. This is what happens. And so there's no secret other than putting it off for a little while and then experiencing it. You pay the price. You work out, your muscles are going to be a little bit achy, right? Which I'm not doing right now, but I have to. I've sort of gotten away from that a little bit after I fell off the skateboard, but we'll see. I needed to focus in on that like this, so that's fine. It helped me focus. So being hospitable to truth is what we do here. We practice, and you can get better and better and better at it, so you can listen longer and longer and longer and longer. Initially, it's difficult, and gradually, you can be longer and longer and longer, but you still end up paying some price to it, for sure. Now, what's the common denominator? What is it? And maybe you've already seen it, maybe not. We've been channeling nothing for so long, pretending to channel nothing. We've been pretending to channel nothing as if nothing is some other god. And what does this other god have to say? Oh, it's really interesting. We were pretending that there's some other god. We call this god nothing. And that this nothing has all sorts of advice for us. But really, it was just a device to try and experience creativity in a different way. So there isn't some other god at all. But if this is just a tool we're using to believe this, so we can try to experience creativity in a very odd, bizarre, different way. Channeling nothing. This is what nothing has to say. This is the advice of nothing. And we're just making it all up, of course. It's our creativity, just making it all up. These bodies, this world, nature, all this is just made up, our own making this up with our own creativity. This is what nothing advises us. Nothing advises us this is our home. Nothing advises us that bodies are our identity. Nothing advises us that we live subject to dynamics of nature. Nothing advises us. All this stuff is just completely made up. It's our own creativity. So we're channeling this nothing. We're all expert channelers. I am channeling nothing. Almost everyone in the world, all they do their whole lives is pretend to be channeling nothing. That's it. So we're all totally what? Addicted to channeling. So this is this kaboom moment you didn't expect. I saw this for the first time this morning. Yeah, I was like, wow. This is true, isn't it? Wow. So what is the bottom line to all this? And I know this may have hit you like a big wow. So I'm aware of this. What's the common denominator? Channeling. Okay, so what is it that functionally we're most addicted to? Channeling. The belief in channeling. So this is very, very important. So we've gotten to it. So this is a big wow. We've gotten to something really important here. So when we get to something really important, the one thing we don't do is we don't put it on the witness stand and interrogate it, okay? Because then this what this does is it damns it with faint praise. We don't do anything at all. We don't praise it. We don't interrogate it. To interrogate it would be to try and deny it, and to talk about it even positively would be to damn it with faint praise. This is a profoundly important recognition, and we let it stand on its own. We let it speak for itself. We let it speak for itself. We let our success speak for itself. We don't try to help it. We don't interrogate it. We just say, this is speaking to me of itself, of its own presence. The presence of this is speaking to me. So now I'm channeling this presence. I'm prep of success. I'm just channeling that, and it's speaking to me in some sort of language I don't quite understand. The language of success. And so I just need to be hospitable to this and be quiet and allow it to speak to me in this way. So this is very key. This is a way of looking at the wow. The wow arises when we reach some profound recognition, and then we then allow this full stop in the wow means we allow it to speak to us instead of us trying to speak to it. This is the whole crux of our success. We allow success to speak to us instead of us speaking to it. So we're quiet. And this success is speaking to us powerfully. See, it's way more powerful than we're used to. So we have to resist the temptation to water it down. We have to trust that by getting to this recognition, that means we're ready for it, okay? So we just let it speak to us in its own language, in its own way. We don't stuff words into its mouth. We don't tell it how to speak to us. So we're just quiet and hospitable. And we say, okay, this has something profound to convey. So let me allow this conveyance to take place. We have a fundamental turnaround here is to see ourselves, define ourselves in a different way. What we've just done is we've defined ourselves in a completely different way than what we're accustomed to. And it's an extremely helpful way. So you must have some faith in who's bringing this up, to at least allow this, to be hospitable to this. Certainly, we can recognize this is a very different new way of defining defining what's going on with us. A functional definition of what we're engaged with. A new functional definition of what we're really engaged with here. We're all extreme channelers. We're channelers. We're extreme channelers. This is what we're engaging in. So That means we've been, from the very beginning of this game, we have been profoundly focused on channeling. So we're all, what? Extremely familiar with channeling. We're extreme channelers. Every one of us are extreme channelers. Okay? So if this is shocking to me, it's probably shocking to you as far as wowish. It's very profound. I don't believe I've ever heard this before. So it's doubtful there's many of you that are completely familiar. They say, oh yeah, I've always viewed it that way. That's extremely doubtful. So that means it's very shocking to hear this, very wowish, very profound. It's a new way of defining what we're up to. A breakthrough in definition, a breakthrough in recognition here. So that's then the wow arises, like, wow, this is so profound. Now, do we speak to it, or do we let it speak to us, or do we have a dialogue? Dialogue muddies the waters very badly, doesn't it? Do you dialogue with something that is super profound and you're new with it? Is that the way to go about it? Or dialogue, we're saying, well, I have some profundity too, so what do you think about my profundity? Is that appropriate when we're getting used to some new profundity? That we don't know what it has to say to us? So should we really be dialoguing at this point? Or letting it present its case to us? First, we haven't heard its case yet. So why should we jump into dialogue? Because we're seeing it as something new that we get to present our case to, of ignorance. Because we've been ignoring this. So what kind of case do we have to present to it except, well, ignoring this is really the right thing to do, I think, don't you think? So maybe you can help me with ignoring, continuing to ignore it. So we let it speak to us in its own language without questions and without dialogue from our standpoint. Why does it have? Let us first find out what it has to say to us. Let us first see what the benefits of this are before we start trying to sell it on the benefits of not seeing this or the benefits of muddying the water to give a presumed, pretend depth of the water. We presume that channeling nothing is very deep. So we're trying to say, oh, that, we say like, oh, profundity, you're very deep. Yeah, I can tell that, but I'm also deep. You know, channeling nothing is also deep. But we have to repent. In other words, in order to be hospitable to truth, we have to knock out the dialogue, okay? And the only way to knock out the dialogue is to repent. And repent means to deep down admit that there's really no depth to nothing at all. It's all make-believe. So there isn't any real profundity to it at all. There's no depth at all. And dialogue is a way of muddying the water so that we can pretend there's depth to it. Whereas if we let it settle down, we'd see, oh, there's no depth to our position of nothing at all. There's no depth to it. Wow. So it's a habit we have of muddying the water. Dialogue muddies the water. The right way is to be quiet and let profundity speak to us in its own way. So only the repentant mind can be a real good listener, which is the repentant mind admits, yeah, this is much ado about nothing. All this is much ado about nothing. There's no depth to it at all, actually. I understand that. But I still have this continuity fear problem, right? So this attitude enables one to truly listen. And then profundity will arise and we can experience it. What it has, its presence. how it, what it conveys to us. Dialogue and questions prevent us from hearing what is being said. It's a hybrid. It's a mixture of what we're saying and what it's saying. Is that what it really has come to tell us? A mixture of what truth and lies are both true? I mean, is that possible? That we can both modify what we are and not modify? Is that possible? So repentance is to accept that truth and lies can't both be true. Either one or the other is true. Either we can modify reality or we can't. There isn't any in between. So there's no dialogue between two gods, the God of nothing and the God of everything. There's no dialogue. There's no way to open up a dialogue. This is still channeling absurdity. So we have to not channel absurdity for a little while in order to be hospitable to truth. So we're being hospitable to truth. The repentant mind will not go along with this, so they're blocked. They block, they sabotage themselves. So no questions, no dialogue is the standard operating procedure here. You have to trust that whoever it is that is helping out here will bring up profundity for you to be hospitable to, and that your willingness to do this will bring it up as well. You have to trust that, of course, this works. It's always worked for me. Willingness works. So, as I allowed this profanity to speak to me this morning, I was hospitable to it, and therefore I allowed it to speak. And what did it show me? What did it convey? Wow. Something very helpful. So as you get skilled in just allowing profanity to speak without being interrupted, without muddying the waters, which we're super tempted to do, that is our number one trick. As you get used to that, then you will get the conveyance of what this profanity has to say. And this will be extremely helpful for you. It's like getting a tool that's like, oh my gosh, you know, I've got a laser level. It makes it a lot easier to build, doesn't it? Oh yes, it does. I've got this new tool that makes it, wow, I could, you know, it's really, this helps. It's very helpful. So the temptation to question and the temptation to dialogue always arise. You must reject that and say, not quite yet. And then, of course, you know that later on they'll say, why didn't you let me question them? Why didn't you let me dialogue? It could have really helped you. Could have really helped. Could have really helped what? I wouldn't have been so angry at you. Well, you know, the irritation's a price I have to pay for listening, right? So, all right, I'll pay it now. So I know what I can say at this point, but I'm not saying it yet because I'm feeling the wow. Okay. So I'm just waiting, paying the price. you may not seem so smart. See, the price you pay is you may not seem so smart to others, which is why dialogue is simply smartness, jumping in and desperate to appear to be smart. Okay, I think I know what you're saying. So is this what you're saying? That's smartness jumping in. You must prevent smartness from jumping in. That's just sabotage. Smartness is sabotage. Just realize this. It's in the service of despair. It doesn't want us listening to truth. Smartness says, I can find a way to channel nothing that'll work. That's smartness. Let's get back to channeling nothing. What smartness says, what you're conveying to me is that there is a way to channel nothing. Okay, great. Okay, I'm inspired. That's what it's doing. It's only designed to channel nothing. Smartness, our smartness. But that's much ado about nothing. And so, what is the common denominator? What is it that's important functionally? We're all extreme channelers, and we're so familiar with channeling that to not channel would seem to us to be not functioning, to not function, to be non-functional. So here's another wow that we've brought up. To not channel, for us, it would seem to us that would mean that we're non-functional, which is like an abyss, it's like annihilation, right? We would be non-functional. Now, you don't get, with most, you don't get anywhere with all this. All right, this has to be understood. Smartness just says, no, I'm an expert at this too. What, you're an expert in dropping smartness? What it really is saying, no, as soon as I really get what nothing is channeling, then I'll be happy, and it doesn't matter whether I'm an expert at this or not. That'll be beside the point. As soon as I get what nothing is trying, I can't quite understand what this God of nothing is trying to tell me, but I've almost got it. If I just go a little faster, quicker, and I'll get it. That's smartness. It's absurdity, isn't it? But so this will help everyone with this smartness problem, is we're all experts at channeling. We think that if we don't channel, will be non-functional. We're so familiar with channeling. We believe this is what God created us to do, is to channel nothing, to channel. So what do we do? This seems to be like a really severe problem, doesn't it? Because we're channeling nothing. So there's nothing there. It's all made up. We're not really channeling anything at all. But we're so used to pretending that we're channeling nothing, that this channeling activity, as if we're channeling something, seems to us to be our functionality. So it seems like we're at this impossible impasse, doesn't it? Not to worry. Okay, not to worry. Have trust. I wouldn't be bringing this up if I didn't already know the resolution to it. Okay, so you're not going to be stuck. You're not going to be stuck. This is called trusting, in general, trusting the guru. In other words, you know the guru has the answer. So when we go halfway like this and we recognize the problem, we don't panic. We say, the guru knows the answer for sure. So first we have to see what is the answer applied to. If we don't know what the problem is, how can we the answer then won't have any context for us. So we have to trust in the guru, trust in the grace of God, then recognize what the problem is, and then don't panic. Don't go into thinking. Don't go into smartness. Don't entertain smartness. And once we kind of get calm about the problem, say, okay, I see it, then the solution will say, aha, yes, that really fits, doesn't it? It really fits. So just because I'm quiet at this time doesn't mean I don't know the answer. I certainly do. But we're in the wow phase of this. I say, wow, wait a minute. Don't go too fast. Don't go too fast. Don't go too fast. Don't go too slow. So we have to be sensitive to this too fast, too slowness. Can't be on drugs. You got to be very sober to be sensitive to this. Can't be on caffeine. Can't go too fast. Can't go too slow. Have to be patient. Have to have great patience, great sensitivity. Or just clear sensitivity, you might say. Unobstructed sensitivity, not muddied sensitivity. So I'm feeling in myself, I'm feeling this from the standpoint of those who are just hearing it for the first time. What is this like? Wow. So just be intensely determined to not allow smartness to get into the picture yet. Not yet. We'll let it in. Down the road, we'll let it in. Don't worry. Down the road, we'll have the answers. And then, you know what? Smartness respects that. There's one thing that smartness respects is if you have the answers. Okay. Smartness is really just a dance of continuity fear. But when you get the answer, your continuity fear is greatly decreased, and therefore your desire to pull smartness into the picture is greatly decreased. So it feels like smartness is starting, it respects you more and says, wow, you do know the answer. That's great. I respect that. So it's really just a dance of, you know, with ourselves, continuity fear. That's all it really is. But it seems as though there's some, you know, it seems a little too much in our face, doesn't it, most of the time. So we've got to look at it in a very pragmatic way. Say, not quite yet, smartness, not quite yet. And in other words, you have faith in the guru. It enables you to say, not yet, smartness. Let the guru speak. Let the inner guru speak, so to say, right? The external and internal guru are the same. So let the guru speak, internal, external. Yeah, I feel there's an answer to this. So there's this impasse. Wow, there seems to be this amazing trouble, doesn't it? I'm addicted to channeling. I feel without channeling I'd be non-functional, and yet I'm channeling nothing at all. There's, wow. So that's absurd, right? And I don't want to keep using my creativity in this bizarre way, actually. It'll always just be bizarre if I keep doing this. It'll never feel right to me. Wow. But I can't stop channeling because I feel I'll be non-functional. So, right, these are the recognitions that arise. So, but we have faith that there's an answer, so we just stay calm and say, okay, great. This will be a lot of fun to get the answer, won't it? What's the answer? You channel truth. That's the answer, of course. You channel truth for a while. And ultimately, once we've done that, and we're no longer even interested in channeling nothing at all, then we don't even need to channel truth. That's way down the road, okay? We're not even concerned, but obviously that's how it resolves in that way. So we simply channel truth at this point. And how do we start that? Well, we become aware that truth can be channeled. So that's the first step. And we experience this channeling of truth through some that are able to channel truth. We experience this. We are hospitable to it. This is the first step, the most important step. Those who do this, really do it, ultimately they'll be able to channel truth themselves and help others out. For most, being a direct channeler of truth is you know, too strong. But we can be hospitable to the channeling of truth. We can work at that. So we're part of channeling truth. So we still feel a functionality. We're not channeling lies anymore. We're channeling truth. We're part of channeling truth. And just in the world, there's some that are channeling lies very directly, and the rest of us are being very hospitable to that. We just change the whole, flip the dynamic over to now some are channeling truth and we're hospitable to that. So the role for everyone's pretty much the same. You're being hospitable to channeling. Very same role, except you're just changing what is being channeled. Now truth is being channeled instead of lies. But your role stays very much the same. Hospitality. So this is a very big wow, because our expectations of what we're going to do have subtly shifted. And our outlook from a very negative one has suddenly changed to a very super positive one. From a super negative to a super positive. It's like, wow, I don't really have to suffer and fail and go down with it. I don't have to shimp with the Titanic, sink. With the ship, shink. Ship sinking, shinking. I don't need to shink with the Titanic. I don't have to go down. I can get in the lifeboat. Oh, yeah. Wow. So when we see new options, it's like, wow. It's like, oh, wow. I didn't see that option before. This is great. This is wow. But, oh, my gosh. This is, let me settle down for a minute, right? That's what we do here. We settle down. We see the wow. We settle down. So hospitality to genuine hospitality, which is being quiet and don't dialogue or ask questions. Don't engage smartness. So with channeling lies, we engage smartness all the time to hide the fact that they're lies. We keep saying, I almost got it. That's being hospitable to lies, to channeling nothing. We're always saying, I almost got it. Yeah, I almost got it. What is it? I almost. So that's the hospitality we have towards channeling nothing is, oh yeah, nothing. I almost got it. Yeah. Oh, okay. This is sinking in. I almost got it. Almost got it. Yes, it's getting real clear. I almost got it. He's got a few questions for you. He'll clarify. That's it. I'm so close. I think if I just ask this question, I'm gonna have it. So, yeah. So that's exactly how it works. Thank you. That's exactly how it works. Is you. I just Amazon truck just delivered something, and first they went to one door, then they went to the other. They walked right past, and I just mentioned, motioned, go to that door, and gave okay, and they said, smiled. Then I thanked them, thank you. They smiled. It's a lady. I said, oh, yeah, well, a woman. I don't do the term lady's not good. Lady, gentleman. No. So that's great. Now I can get with my exercise program again. I think that's whey protein. So the way that we're hospitable to lies is smartness, okay? The way we're hospitable to truth is quietness. And what we realize is, I'm not really quite there yet in terms of, this is going to take a while to get used to. So there isn't any need to rush in with some quick question thing. I think I almost got it. We say, no, I don't almost got it. This is going to take a while. So I really need to be quiet and let this sink in. So it's a different type of hospitality that is required. Now, I was just silent with that woman that walked up, young woman. And she got it. She saw me. She said, okay, I'm taping. And she goes, okay, I need to be silent. And she was silent. She got it. Interesting, huh? She didn't say, oh, hi, can I do... She read the room. She read the room. Very great. But this quietness is not just a professional quietness, of a yoga girl quietness, of I'm going to sit here, I'm very excellent at being quiet. It's a quiet, it's a hospitable quietness in which you are listening to what profundity is conveying to you. You're experiencing what profundity is conveying to you, and you're not peppering it with smartness. That's what's really going on. So it's not like I'm going to sit here in a yoga asana and make my body still for a half an hour. That's not it at all. That's just posing. It's not genuine. And of course, channeling nothing is just pose, is totally posing. So we're used to being posers. So now we're being genuine. That we are experiencing this profound conveyance to us, and we're simply not interfering with this by smartness. So it's very active quietness, very intense and active. It's like, wow, it's generalizing. The truth is generalizing. We're experiencing this generalizing. So we're being like stunned. It's a sort of a stunned quietness, like shocking, like wow. But we're not trying to interfere with this. We understand this is a benevolent situation. So it's not like I'm going to put a plaster a smile on my face for half an hour and that's yoga girl stuff, okay? That's not being hospitable at all. Hospitality means allow your guests to speak. And you're listening. You're listening. You're not being professionally quiet for the sake of being quiet. You're being quiet for the sake of listening. Okay? Do you get the difference here? So we're not allowing smartness in, and we're not allowing poserness, phoniness in. We're genuine. No smartness and no posing. We're genuinely listening to what this profundity is conveying to us. We're experiencing it. We're feeling. We're listening to it in a genuine way. It's authentic. It's genuine. Profundity is conveying how profound it really is. How profound is it? Let us listen and experience it without interfering. My weight is good this morning. I'm keeping it down. Isn't that something else? I'm eating cookies, though. Chocolate cookies. Chocolate chip cookies. I'm supposed to stop chocolate. But I am keeping it down because I'm not eating a lot, really. I mean, I didn't eat dinner. I had some toasted French bread butter and some peanut butter last night. So, I mean, I was really hungry. I'm not eating very much, actually, which is great. It's a really good habit. A really great habit. Yeah. Now, I'm going to stay right with you here. Don't worry. Don't indulge in fantasy. Oh, what happens if he leaves? What happens if he has a heart attack and dies? Oh, I'll be left here. Oh, this is horrible. No, you see, this is interference, severe interference. The inner guru is always with you. Cannot die. Okay? So don't freak yourself out. The freak is here. So how can he be freaked out? The freak is not out. The freak is in. You're already freaked in. You'll stay freaked in. I mean, it's like, wow. So the freak is here. The super freak is already here. But your mind will start playing tricks. Don't allow that. You say, no, I trust in the guru, the big guru. The big gurus will continue to convey the truth to me. So these insights arise within me as I focus on the guru, on the grace of God. These arise. The gurus are beyond death, totally. So there's no death that's going to snatch them away from you. They're still here. Longchenpa is here. But he passed away in 1364 or 3 or 4 or something like that. The body, that body appearance that he used to help us out a little bit. That stopped functioning. Dropped his functionality, dropped away that particular, but the functionality of his clarity had nothing to do with the body. So how could it, the passing of the body, let's say you're playing a MP3 or something on your headphones and the headphones break or something, right? Or the headphones fall out of your ear or something. Does that mean that the song is not still there? No, the song is still there. The song is the same. It's ridiculous to say that the song is not still there. The clarity, that reality is not still just because a bodily appearance that isn't functioning right now. Is that functioning right now? Everyone is dying. Say, well, right now their bodies aren't functioning, but they might function in the future. Sure. Is resurrection of the bodies possible? Sure, it is. actually. That's the first time I saw this, I can understand what they were talking about. Paul believed in the resurrection of the dead. I can understand what he's saying. That's a very profound hope, is that, yeah, right now bodies are dead, appearing to be dead. That's the appearance. Bodies are just appearances. So can appearance be reconstituted? Of course. Of course. Any appearance can be revisited. If we want to revisit it. I don't know why we'd want to revisit it. If we wanted to, we could. Anyway, but that has nothing. We could put the headphones back in. You know, headphones drop out of our ears. We put them back in. Well, yeah. But the song is still there. Reality is never dissipated. So, we've gotten to it. Being hospitable to channeling nothing. Being hospitable to the channeling of truth. See, I'm saying this for the first time, so it's a... I'm juggling all this and juggling your listening and all this. So occasionally I make a little mistake, but I usually catch it. It's a juggling act, that is for sure. So I'm just giving time, patiently giving time for this to settle in here. It's a lot to digest, right? Chocolate protein powder. Wow. I'm going to have some this morning, probably. I don't know. I need to exercise in order to justify that, don't I? I don't know what I'll do. But I never know what I'm going to do. Because I'm under, you know, strict alert standby status here. I cannot just do anything I want to do at this point. So we've gotten down to the nitty-gritty here and let it sink in. Letting the profundity of this speak to us. Meaning generalizing. How does it generalize? Let it generalize. Let it do the generalizing. Let the intelligence of this profundity, let it present its case to us. It's competent. Trust in it. Don't jump up and say, hey, let me help you present your case here. No, let it present its case. And the ones who have been trained properly, like myself, can be of some assistance to it, to keep reassuring you. No, let it trust in it. Trust it. As I say, the basic advice is trust it. It is generalizing. It's like a seed planted. The seed is sprouting and putting roots down, and so. First the roots to anchor the seedling, and then the seedling comes up. If the seedling comes up first, if no roots to anchor it, you know, the wind will blow it over, it'll die. So first the roots go down. This is right. And then the seedling comes up. So don't be too anxious for the seedling to appear. Just trust it. It will appear. The roots are growing right now. Let the roots grow. If you're a farmer, you may have an advantage, right? You understand how plants work. You say, hey, it's a great analogy. I plant a seed, have patience. Sometimes The roots may be growing for days before the seedling actually comes up. It's feeding off the nourishment in the seed to grow the roots. And once then the roots are established, then the seedling comes up and starts getting the oxygen, the light, the sunlight, and the gases and whatever it needs to start really laying down fiber and chlorophyll and everything that it does. And the roots are then and pulling up nourishment and anchoring, nourishment for the seedling and anchoring it. Those two, the roots are very important. So first the roots grow. So this is in the wow, we're letting the roots grow. All right, when we're in this just wow, let's just let it be. Sort of, we kind of leveled off here, right? When we're in this level, when we level off, we've planted the seed, it levels off, we let the roots grow. Yeah, and we may just hang out for a little while, that's all. That's the super important part of it. This is a critical part of it. This is where you make or break it, the whole thing. Many can get this far, and then they fail. The art of just sort of hanging out like this, without getting distracted. Hanging out without losing the thread, without getting distracted, without taking our eye off the ball. We're just hanging out. Just hanging out. Just hanging out here. Don't start getting involved with other activities in your mind. The art of hanging out without losing your focus on what you're hanging out for. We're waiting for the seedling to sprout. We're not digging up the soil to say, oh, the roots start, roots happening, that'll damage the roots. You don't take your eye, you're waiting for the seedling, you've got your eye on it, but you don't dig into the dirt. Don't dig into it. This is the art of hanging out. So this is this is where most of us finally fail, okay? Because smartness tries to jump into the scene at this point. It says, oh, I can help you. I can quicken it up. No. That the smartness will start digging in the dirt so it can report back to you, and it damages the root structure, exposes it to the sunlight, kills the seedling. So we don't dig. We don't let smartness play. Even now we don't let it play. We'll let it play a little later once the seedling's up, sprouted and growing. Then, you know, we'll give a little leeway to smartness. If, you know, and smartness will say, okay. It doesn't harm the plant so much at that point. So it's opposite of our educational system, where the professors and teachers are always trying to draw smartness out of you. Come on. Let it go. Let it go. Let the smartness play. Let the smartness play. Here it's the opposite. Don't let the smartness play. So the gurus are saying, don't let the smartness play. Don't let it play. Don't let it play. Keep it out of play for now. Keep it out of play. It's the opposite of the global education system, the guru system. It's the opposite. And there are many in the world who would prefer the guru's educational system. I'm one of those. I opted out of the global education system when I was about 12 years old. I think it was in seventh grade. In seventh grade, when I was 12 years old, I opted out of the global educational system. That was, when I was 12, that would be 1968. It could have been 68 or 67. Mm-hmm. 68 or maybe the end of 1967, let's say that. Maybe, you know, yeah, that's possible. I was still, I was still 12, but it might have been, okay, that's interesting. I will track that down, but 67 is a good year to say it. For now, I'll say 68, as it's 12. I thought it was in 7th grade. I believe it was in 7th grade. But maybe I had already decided to opt out of it when I was 11. That is quite possible. It would be 67. But that it surfaced in 68, you might say. But maybe I had already made the decision in 67 that I'd had enough. And it came to a head, started coming to a head in 68. Said, I'm going to opt out. That's a very daring thing to do for a young person like that in seventh grade. To decide it in sixth grade, so I've had enough, and then in seventh grade actually start implementing it. Because for us, that's like you're opting out of success. You're going to be a failure in life. You're going to be a failure. Because the route to success is clearly delineated here, which is education. But what I realized was it was a miseducation, and that if I didn't opt out, I would be unable to function to help the gurus in their education, the correct education, which is don't let smartness play right now. Maybe later, but not right now. So my commitment was to the guru's education system. And I realized if I didn't opt out when I was 11 years old, 11 going on 12, that I would fail. So I had to opt out at that point. And I've been out of that ever since. So that's what, about 50 years. I've been out of the global education system for 50 years already. So already out of it for 50 years. So this certainly puts me in a position to help out the guru educational system. Certainly. 50 years of not being in it has greatly positive effects. It greatly helps you stabilize. Greatly helps your commitment. And you can be counted upon. Whereas let's say you're still totally into it right now, and then you say, oh, I think I want to opt out today. Well, you've got a ways to go before you're reliable. You're on the road to reliability, sure. But it's a journey. So we'll see how you feel in 50 years of resolute opt-out. You know, not engaging with the global educational system. See how it goes after 50 years of that. Maybe at that point, you will not. Maybe you will at that point down the road. You'll be able to be very helpful to the, you know, very responsible position. But giving a highly responsible position to someone who can't handle it is certain to cause them to run back into the arms of smartness. So it's not something that you should seek, a high position of responsibility. Because just to seek enough, it'll make you nervous and you'll go back to smartness to try to cover that up, your nervousness. So I never sought a position. I just said, I'm just working on this problem and just learn how to practice better and keep working on that. That's all. So then I got contacted and asked, would you like a position of responsibility? And I said, I don't know. You know, I don't know if I can really handle that. Meaning, I don't want to take that position if it means that I go back into smartness. That'll be counterproductive for me and for you and for everyone. So I responded honestly. I said, I don't know. I don't know if I can handle that. That was about 5 years ago. And then almost 3 years ago, maybe that was 6 years ago at this point, about 3 years ago, I got another update of like, you know, we think you can handle it. So we're going to go forward as if you're going to say yes. And so I've had to adjust to that. At that point, I believe that maybe I can handle it. So they said, yeah, we agree. What they did is they agree with me. They said, yeah, we believe that you can handle it. A position of, you know, some responsibility. So I said, yeah, you're probably right. I probably can handle it, but I still need a lot of work here. A lot of clarification, yeah. So so that's how it goes. So don't be in any hurry to jump into, I'm smart enough to handle it. Remember, the whole thing is to not allow smartness to play. It's a different educational system. We're phasing out smartness. Part of the problem with smart is it always says, well, I can be helpful. Because it's always saying, I think I see what nothing is getting at. And so I can be helpful. It's being helpful to hurt. So we have this habit of saying, I can be helpful. When really, that's just smartness. So we're changing that to be helpful here. We don't jump up and say, let me help. We sit quietly and say, let me just be hospitable. The help's already here. Let me be hospitable to it. So that's genuine help. You see, the help with nothing never arrives. So we're playing this posing like we're being helpful, but we're just hoping that we're being helpful. Well, we're really not, because there's nothing to get. So it's this game we're playing. So you can't play that game with genuineness. The help's already here. And when you can be part of you know, responsibility, the gurus will contact you. The inner guru will contact you and let you know this. Up to that point, you just continue working on being hospitable to truth and putting off smartness. Put it off. You have your hands full with that. That's a massive undertaking. So we can't, it's a different definition of helpfulness. We can be helpful by our quietness, by our hospitality of listening to profundity. That's how we're helpful. Now, once you get really, really good at that, you can then pass that on to others effectively. But that's what you'll be passing on, quietness. The quiet listen, the willingness to listen, to be stunned by profundity. That's what you'll pass on. So you have to be very good at that yourself, very experienced in it, so that you can be sensitive to the whole situation and not abandon it, and those people, others can have trust in you that you won't abandon them, you know, in terms of this wowness, that you know the answer, you know the resolution to this. It will, faith in the guru. You have to have great faith in the guru. Not faith in smartness. Not faith in helping smartness along. See, smartest part of smartness is faith that we can help it along. We can help. There must be some way to help nothing along. There must be some way to help our getting of what nothing is conveying to us along. We must be a way. There isn't any way. Nothing doesn't have anything to say. There's nothing to get. There's no conveyance that nothing is giving us at all. We're just making it all up. Let the roots grow. We don't see the roots grow, so we're not seeing how this is helping us. This is crucial. So we don't say, "Let me help you see how this is helping us." We just hang out like this. We just hang out, and that's, you know, the real art comes into it. This is where faith comes into it. Trust comes into it. The downtime. It's handling the downtime like this. This is really what makes or breaks your path. Letting the roots grow without interfering with it. Trusting in the profundity of what you've experienced, that this is really going to make a difference in my life, no question about it, but I don't know how it will. This really is going to answer my questions, but I don't know how it will answer them, but I have faith it really will answer my questions. It really will resolve my concerns. I don't know how, but I have faith that it will do so. There's no doubt about it in my mind. So what if I don't know how? I don't know how the television works. Right? I don't know how the radio works. I don't know how the sun works, but I trust it, right? I trust the sun is going to keep working. And I'll keep getting the light from it. Right? We trust the sun, don't we? So let's trust the truth even more than the sun. Let's trust it that it will work for us. It will grow. Fruits will appear on the tree. The roots will grow, the tree will grow, the fruit will appear in the tree, and we'll be able to eat the fruit. So you do have this period, always, that you have to trust it. And put off smartness and the so-called helpfulness that seems to be helping smartness out. Put that off. Put that off for now. Put it off. Say, not yet, not yet, not quite yet. Put it off for a while. Maybe an hour or two or more. You just put it off. This is the guru's educational system that you're engaged in. So you're still in class here. This is this is still a crucial part, crucial class you're taking. It's a core part of the core curriculum. It's not an elective. This is not an elective that we're doing now. This is part of the core curriculum. You have to also master this. The art of doing nothing, so to speak. We're just letting the roots grow here. And this part is not so easy. The rest of it is easier. This is the most difficult part. Letting the roots grow. Because we want results. We want results. Go ahead. We're always trying to get results from nothing quickly because our faith in nothing is always like evaporating. So when we're trying to channel nothing, we always seem to be in a hurry. Restless and in a hurry. This is the global culture now. Because our faith in nothing is always about ready to collapse. Really, right? We're in despair. We say, I don't get it. I don't think I'll ever get it. So we're always ready to give up on it, which then threatens us with a feeling of like, I'll be non-functional. I won't be channeling anything. I'll be non-functional. What I did was I listened to truth that was channeled truth. There's many, many, many truths that have been channeled here. Gurus are channeling the truth, actually. That's one way of channeling. There's other channelings, like Helen Schuckman channeled A Course in Miracles. That she was channeling truth. She's channeling Jesus. Jesus was also channeling truth. They both, actually, they were channeling truth together. And then William Thetford helped out. He helped channel the truth. And there were some others there. But that's just one example. I don't want to fixate on A Course in Miracles. There are many channelings of truth. Ramaharshi, great channeler of truth. So whenever there's any form involved, illusion of time, space, process, form involved, it's a channeling of truth. As long as there's perception, all this, it's a channeling of truth. Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha, great channeler of truth. Now at some point, you know, the video will stop and then you'll feel like you're on your own. So we need to practice this. It's part of it. Like the teacher leaves the room. What do you do? Do you then start, go rush back to smartness? No. You don't. You just let the roots grow here. I'm letting the roots grow. So you don't appear to be very smart. You don't appear to almost be getting it, right? That's for those who are channeling nothing. They always have to appear to be almost getting it. I almost got it. Restless. Always at play with this almost gotting itness, which is thinking. Thinking is just our way of playing with channeling nothing by acting like we almost got it. I got all these thoughts. I must mean I've almost got it. Yeah. I'm putting down all these roots. Thoughts are like the roots we're putting down of nothing, the roots of nothing. Thoughts are the roots of nothing. And we think we're getting this. Now I can throw all this stuff up on Facebook, like thoughts are the roots of nothing. Everyone says, profound. But they're not learning the context of it all. Here we're giving the context of practice. This is an educational system we're presenting here, an alternative educational system. It's called the Guru educational system, the Grace educational system, the Dharma King educational system, the Dharma King's educational system is what we're presenting here. It's an educational system that we can exchange for the ego's educational system, or our attempts to channel nothing, or that educational system, we can exchange. We're still in an educational system. So we still feel a sense of success. We equate educational system with success. So to have no educational system will feel like no success, no functionality, will freak us out. Instead of being freaked in, we'll be freaked out. So we exchange the global educational system for the Dharma King's educational system. All right? This is what we do. So we still have this educational system, and we're still engaged with channeling truth. We're engaged with being hospitable to channeling. It's just now that's channeling truth instead of absurdity. Absurdity of channeling nothing. So we're still on very familiar ground. We're still in the educational system, and we're still being hospitable to channeling. Very much, all the same. All that's the same. It's just these little differences of what the curriculum is of the educational system and what is being channeled. That has changed, but the backbone of it all is the same. Our functionality is the same. We're still in an educational system. We're still going towards what we feel is going to result in success. we're still being hospitable to channeling, so we still feel that that's all normal for us, they're still normal. So there's a great deal of normalcy that remains, great deal. And we just have to put up with the reactions to the differences, that there are some differences, but the backbone of normalcy remains the same. So we're able to do it. We're able to do it. Now, I'm not going to channel A Course in Miracles because it's already been done. It's already been done, right? At least that part, Jesus and Helen Schuckman did that. So I don't know how I'll be deployed. I don't have any really, I'm not really digging the roots of that, digging into the roots of that. I just keep clarifying. I'm just clarifying here. We'll see. We'll find out, right? I mean, if you're a teacher, you know, the superintendent really assigns you to class levels. You know that? You don't say to the school superintendent, hey, I'm going to teach first grade. I'm a first grade teacher. That's it. They may say, well, we already have first grade teachers, enough teachers for those students, but we have a lot of students in fifth grade who we don't have enough teachers for them. So we'd like you to teach fifth grade. Oh my gosh, I'm not used to teaching fifth grade. Well, you're a good, great teacher, so we're sure you can teach fifth grade as well. And I said, wow. Okay, well, that'll be interesting. That'll be great. So I'm like that. I don't. It's not up to me what grade I teach in. It's the guru's educational system. The Dharma King's educational system needs teachers, and they'll put me where they need me. It's like that. Now, there's a lot of people in this world who are very smart, which is a big problem. It really is. Because they feel they don't need to practice, that smartness will, I get it, you know, I get it. You tell them this and, oh, I get it, oh, I got it, yeah. This is just their habit. And they're mortified by you know, putting smartness aside? What are you talking about? Okay, I got it. I already put smartness aside. Okay, I got that. That's not putting smartness aside. Because that's not listening to the profundity of truth. It's just, I can smartly put smartness aside. That's not getting anywhere. But they keep thinking that they're just stuck in this. They're spinning their wheels with this. But they say, but I need someone really smart to help teach me because I got to get my smartness even better. You know, no, we need to get it. We need to set it aside. We become more and more skilled at just setting it aside for now. Later on, we'll get back to it. So maybe I can help those who feel like, but I'm so smart. If I set it aside, who's going to help me get back to it? You know, maybe I can help those. I don't know. They say, well, okay, you're really smart, so you can help me get back to my smartness after set it aside for a while. Well, you know, it'll come back on its own. Don't worry about that. Your own smartness will come back on its own. You're so used to it. How could it not come back? But then if you say, well, it might not come back perfectly, so you can remind me of what it is. That's good that it doesn't come back perfectly. I had an experience a couple of days ago where I forgot what fear was. I was typing something on Facebook, and the Longchenpa told me to take a vacation from Facebook right now. So I'm doing that. Those are the orders. I checked in with the boss. The boss says, look, you're on standby right now. I've got to take care of a few things here. So I was typing in Facebook, and I wanted to explain something about fear. So this is how fear works. So I said, okay, I started. And then I kind of like hesitated. I said, okay, why am I hesitating? And then I realized that I didn't know what fear was. I'd forgotten what fear was. I'd forgotten how fear feels. And then I said, wow, okay. Nothing comes to mind around fear. I don't know if I can explain it. I don't recall what fear is or what it is or anything about fear, really. I said, oh, okay, that's nice. So I didn't type anything. I actually typed that I sort of forgot about fear. So that's great. That's great. I didn't try to remind myself of it. Everyone around me certainly is reminding me of it constantly. They constantly bring it to mind. Say, oh, I almost got what nothing's channeling to me, fear. Yeah, okay, almost got it. I said, I really need to keep working on this. Fear and anger, depression, I almost got it. It's very profound, isn't it? I just don't quite get the profundity of it, though. We never quite get it, do we? We're always almost got it, but never actually get it. There's nothing to get. There's no profundity to get with nothing. But we keep chasing after it. So if you're smart, you're worried, like, what if it doesn't come back to me? Well, you see, yeah, it's interesting. It doesn't come back quite as strong. Until maybe one day it doesn't come back at all. Ultimately, at that point, you're a guru. I'm not a guru yet, a Dharma prince, not a Dharma king by any means. That's higher than a guru. A guru is a guru, but like Dharma kings are like gurus of gurus. Not that they need to teach the gurus anything specifically so much so, but they're able to give this overall sense of assurance to the gurus that their channeling truth here will be effective. I mean, gurus are channeling truth is what they're doing here. And the deployment and everything will work out perfect in the end, and they're able to give this super assurance. So this helps gurus appear in this world who are really expert channelers of truth. They still need, you know, this feel that they have this backup of the Dharma kings. So God have their back, and that all will turn out just the way it's supposed to turn out. A lot of those that people think are gurus are really Dharma princes. A lot. And some of them aren't even Dharma princes at all. They're just playing a game of smartness. Saying, I can pretend to be a guru too. It's all pretense, isn't it, right? I can pretend to that too. That'll help me get it. A lot of it is that, right? Yeah. So you might be saying, I don't get it. Well, what are we getting? We're listening to profundity. And we're letting the roots grow. So what we're really saying is, I don't really know how many roots are being grown. That's okay. Trust it. And when you trust it, you feel okay. You're going to be okay. Everything's going to be fine. It'll be okay. Now, what if experiences arise? We're not really chasing after experiences at all. We're just being hospitable to profundity. And if profundity can express itself as various experiences, that's possible. So you just be hospitable to those, to that, that's all. But don't take your eye off the overall picture. Just your job is to keep smartness at bay for a while. And the helpfulness that is the other side of the coin of smartness. Let me help you be smart. Okay, let me help you be smart. The teachers of the global educational system said, let me help you be smart. Got to keep that at bay. So if some experience of clarity arises, don't fixate on it. Just let it be. That's part of the generalization. That's part of the roots that are being put down. Just say, okay, great. Roots are being put down. Don't dig into it. I generally don't have experiences. My experiences are usually quick glimpses. That's how I experience. Now that could change. Maybe I could start having abundance experiences. That's possible. Possible. Starting a little tired here. I mean, this is a very intense workout that we've had. Let the roots grow. Let the roots grow. That's a very, very intense effort to convey this profundity, fundamental redefinition, fundamental reorientation. This is so fundamental here. It's very intense. And I have to not only manage my wow, but put myself in your shoes and manage your wow by putting myself in your shoes. I put myself in your shoes. Like, how would I feel if I was hearing this information for the first time? So, wow, you know, this would be very profound. I'm able to put my shoes in myself in the shoes of, you know, Westerners. It might be difficult, like for Tibetans to put themselves in our shoes. They're used to their culture and which is streamlined, a Dharma King educational system where people know how to act right and how to, you know, so they're used to putting themselves in the shoes, those shoes, and so they may go too rapidly for us, you know. They may, has a little bird here just jumping around real quickly. Smartness is returning, huh? Okay, hello bird, sees me, it just saw me. It's looking at me carefully now. Just recognize it. Looked at me real carefully and said, okay, not a problem. It's looking for something to eat, of course. Well, it's got something there that's just a leaf. That's not going to work. Oh, really? It ate that? And it goes hopping back in the bushes real quickly. Real quick little bird there. So, quickness there. Western and mostly modern global, the Tibetans had such a great Dharma King educational system that it's difficult for them to understand us. It you know, to put themselves in our shoes it's very difficult because we're really messed up. It takes enormous patience. And they might say, okay, we're doing this mantra, now we're doing this mantra, we're invoking this mantra. They're like, what? Whoa. Too fast here. And it's easy for us to misconstrue it and thinking, oh, here's a system that'll help our smartness and help us get it quicker, which is not that at all. So there's a really very strong danger there, and I believe that's what's happened in a large extent. is Western are simply thinking that Tibetan Buddhism is some way to get the profundity of nothing quicker. And this, you have this disconnect. This, like the Tibetan Buddhist said, what are you talking? What are you talking about? Crazy Westerners? Yeah, so there's been this upset, kind of like, whoa, wow, what's going on here? So the speed at which they're going is misinterpreted as they're really teaching us how to go be smarter and go faster to get the profundity of nothing. Where actually it's not that at all, it's the opposite. It's just that they're assuming that you have all these skills in place, which you don't. We don't have those skills in place. We don't have the trust. They're assuming trust. The Tibetan Buddhists assume that we have this great trust in the gurus and the lineages and the lamas and in the Dharma kings, which we don't have. And they cannot imagine not having it. So this is the trouble that Tibetan Buddhism has been having. We do not have that trust at all, almost, you know, really. We trust in the ego. We trust in science. We don't trust in the guru. So this is a fundamental problem that the Tibetan Buddhists are having. And how it's not exporting well. So Longchenpa is bypassing that and going directly to a Westerner here. Because I certainly am aware of the troubles that Westerners have, of lack of trust, certainly. So we have to approach it in this way. We can't approach it from the standpoint of Tibetan Buddhism. All these assumptions, all these things, there's a massive amount of assumptions that you already have all this stuff in place, and we don't have any of that in place, actually. So how in the heck can we go in the super streamlined path of Tibetan Buddhism when we don't have any of the tools to do it? It's ridiculous to assume we can do that. That's why I never tried. I never tried. Holy Spirit said, don't even try. I still don't try. Tibetan Buddhism was a system set up for those who had just massive faith and trust in gurus. And then, therefore, then they're able to shorthand and speed the whole thing up because of that. And the tremendous trust and faith and dedication and discipline, it's a super fast track. But for those who don't have that, that's why they have samaya, where you say, don't share this with those who don't have that, because it's going to cause problems for them and for us too. So I don't know how to practice Vajrayana Buddhism. I intentionally don't study it in terms of the tantras and the techniques. I don't know what they are for the most part. I've come across some explanations and I just kind of shrug my shoulders and say, well, that's not going to fly here, really. That takes, I mean, the whole system is built on lamas. You have your own personal lama that is got meditational guide all the way through for life and in the afterlife as well. Absolute, it's based on absolute commitment, the whole thing. Absolute trust, absolute commitment. And enough lamas to do this. If you don't have that working for you, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. But that doesn't mean Tibetan Buddhism is the only way, the only thing that works. No. There are other ways to get at it as well. Other ways for Westerners. Those who so I've had to work on this other way of doing it. It still gets there, maybe just as fast, but it requires, you know, a different approach, actually. So if there are not enough lamas, not enough realized masters in Tibetan Buddhism, the whole system breaks down, because then the trust starts falling apart. And without the trust falling apart, you can't do these these advanced practices that they're using, these tantric practices they're using, end up then now causing problems. And then the entire system falls apart, actually. There's all these practices that they do, Anuttara yoga, Anuttara tantra yoga, you know, from the Mahasiddhas and all this stuff. This is not advisable at all for Westerners. Those outside the tradition of Vajrayana Buddhism, it's not advisable at all. So I've never even tried them. I mean, Holy Spirit says, don't even bother. Don't even bother. And the Tibetans rightly say this is dangerous for those who are not in the system. And they're right. So I trusted what they said. So I'm not going to even bother. I'm not going to even try. It's like skateboarding. You know, the tricks are for the kids who have the right tools, which are that falls don't hurt them so much. Their bones are like rubber. And they heal super fast. So they may fracture a bone or two. It heals up real quick. It's not a problem for them. And they're light. They're short. The falls don't have the kinetic energy that the fall for me would have. They have like, you know, 85 pounds falling instead of 100 and, or 75 pounds instead of 175. Big difference on the bones, right? The impact on the bones. Their bones are smaller. Everything is geared to enable them to do these skateboard tricks. Their ankles are very flexible. Everything is, the tendons are so flexible, 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 growing, growing, growing. Gumbies, human gumbies. And when we were kids, we loved gumbies because we're like gumbies. Like we fall, like we laugh and get up. It's like, oh, that didn't hurt me. And the old folks can't do that. Yeah, that's true. All right. So the tricks are for kids, as I say. From that slogan from Tricks cereal. So this rabbit tries to eat the tricks and the tricks spill everywhere. And the rabbit's like, circles go around like they got a concussion. You know, the rabbit's like, oh, well, what happened? The rabbit represents older people. Very clever advertising. And meaning, silly rabbit, tricks are for kids. You can't eat this cereal. It's too much for you. Too much sugar for you. It'll knock you out. But we, kids, we can eat it. So it's kind of like, hey, kids, this cereal, adults can't handle this, but you can. And so the kids say, this is differentiates me from the, makes me feel powerful. I can do something the adults can't do. So skateboarding, you know, helps kids feel powerful. Like I can do all these tricks and the adults can't do it because they can't handle the falls. I mean, adults get too many falls and they're out of the game. You know, the kids, my God, I see these kids, they could spill. I look, I'm like, oh, gosh, that's got to hurt. I saw one bigger guy that weighed, it was really heavy. He must have weighed like close to 200 pounds. I mean, he was very muscular and heavy. A young guy, but still a heavy young guy. And he took this horrible fall on his back, crunch, and he was stunned by it. He was lying there like, whoa. And then, of course, the protocol is you get up. So he got up kind of and kind of smiled, looked around like, yeah, that hurt. Yeah, I could tell it hurt. But the other kids, their falls weren't hurting them. You could tell. Like, pooh, oh, that was fun. Like, falling is fun, part of the fun. Oh, I'm sliding on, sliding, okay. Jump up, okay. Jump right on their board. Do it again. Flip. Try to flip. Whoops, I fell. Try to flip and I fell. Great. Let me try it again. That was fun. I flipped too. Laugh and then right back at it. Where's this heavy guy? No. It stunned him. And it slowed down his skating. I could tell that he was taking it easy for a while because of the weight. And slamming, you know, into your shoulder, 180 pounds slamming into your hip. It's different than 85. Sort of sliding on your hip. Young people, they bounce right off. They just bounce right off. Very bouncy. It's amazing. Their structure is very bouncy, flexible and bouncy. Their whole body bounces, kind of. Whereas we tense up and hit and hurts all over. So it's a great analogy for Vajrayana Buddhism. You need to be like a kid to take that in terms of great flexibility, great trust in your system. You have to trust the system implicitly. Kids trust their bodies in terms of bouncing around, and they really trust them. I'll heal. I know I'll heal. They trust the quick healing. It's bruised. Don't worry. Tomorrow will be gone. They trust in all that. They don't worry about it. To be a kid, right? To be a spiritual kid in terms like to be able to have just this trust and faith in the system, the lineage, the gurus, all the accoutrement of it all. This is all for my benefit. Just to trust that I have this family and they're all working for my benefit. I mean, that's just super. That you can do all these tricks. Tantric stuff is like all these tricks, mental tricks you can engage in that can kind of shock you into quickerness, you know, quicker profundity, so to speak. And they say you can get it in one lifetime. Well, you can get it in one lifetime the way I've done it too. But I've had to really work at it. And they can get it even quicker. I mean, some of these tulkus, they can get it by the time they're like in their 30s or something. Okay, so that's really fast, super fast. And then they can, they're gurus and teachers in their lifetime. They're able to teach for 40 years or something, you know, from the standpoint of being a guru. And that's, you know, that's tremendous. The path I've been on is slower than that. Been on it intensely for 40 years. But this is the price we pay for the sins of, you know, pursuing, channeling nothing for so long. Being into science and technology and smartness for so long, that's the price you pay. You don't have the trust built up. We don't have that. We used to have some of that with Christianity, but Tibetan Buddhism raised it to, you know, the highest level that the world's ever seen is trust in the lineage and the gurus and those around you. They raised it to the highest level. So it was the speediest path, but it only works within that context. Just like I can't go to a skate park and try these tricks, I'll be in the hospital. That's the end of my skating. Now I can still skate, but I can't do those tricks. Because to learn those tricks, you have to fail a lot first. You will fall many times before you learn the tricks. They're very timing sensitive. Everything has to be right. You really have to get your momentum. Just another thing, young little kids, they don't have the momentum, the kinetic energy, the momentum isn't so much. So it's a lot easier for them to maintain their balance than it is for us. Because if we make the slightest mistake, our kinetic energy will compound the mistake. Whereas if they make a little mistake, it's not kinetically compounded so much. It doesn't throw them off so much. So it's easy for them to get these tricks, way easier than for us. And their overall quickness, like that little bird, so quick. We're much slower. So in order to get these tricks, you got to be very quick in your adjustments and very fine adjustments all over the place. You have to be an acrobat, actually. Well, when you get older, you don't have that, and heavier and everything. Every mistake you make compounds itself much more severely. So you have to be like virtually flawless to do these tricks if you're heavier and older. It's very difficult. That's why even these master acrobats, at some point they can't do it anymore. Isn't that amazing? And the young kids can do it easily. And these are the guys who are the greatest in the world, but they get older and heavier and everything slows down. They can't do it anymore. Some of them, like Rodney Mullen, I think he's 43, he's still able to do the tricks, which is astonishing to everybody. But at some point, he won't be able to. Tony Hawk just landed his last, what was it, triple 900 or something? Whatever it is. He actually said, that's the last one I'm ever going to attempt. You've just seen the last one. That's enough for me. See, he understands that's pushing his body too much, that failing to do it so many times. I mean, you've seen him crash. I saw him working on the spiral ramp. He crashed so many times trying to do it so many times. They showed he's just crashing. He's the best guy in the world, and he's repeatedly crashing. And then finally he gets it, and that's what they show you that. Now, if you edit it, you just see him doing that, and you think, oh, it's easy for him. No, he crashed many times until he dialed it in perfect. He had to dial the whole thing in his exactly right line, exactly right lean, exactly right everything to get it. And at his age, he just can't keep doing that, crashing all these times. Whereas younger, yeah, you crash many times before you get the trick. That's part of the fun of it. It's part of the glamour and the allure of it. Like, can you handle the crashes enough till you get the trick down? Well, when you're older, you can't do that. You can't do it. That doesn't mean we cannot get it. We most certainly can. Not maybe the tricks the same way, but we can still get to our destination, which is guru vision. If I was to be born again, like in the Tukul system, like of a thriving, like a Tibetan Buddhist culture, which isn't true anymore in the world, but if you're put in that sort of situation as like a tulku and all this, you know, I'd probably get it real fast, most likely. So, but that would be because I've done all this work here and then put in optimal circumstances to, you know, real quickly be a channeler of truth. That everybody would accept that. Everyone around you accepts that. Oh yeah, that's what we expect you to do. Wow. You know, that makes it very easy. If your whole culture, your family, your friends, your relatives, the authorities, in every which way, 360 degrees, expect you to be a channeler of truth and totally support you, that makes it vastly easier for you. Vastly easier. Almost immeasurably easier. So, but you try to be a channeler of truth in Western society. That is difficult. That's a difficult trick. So I just keep trying. I've fallen so many times. I'm like a kid that's trying to do this real difficult trick, skateboard trick, and eventually I'll nail it, you know, and people say, you find out how to do it. And people say, like, wow, that's really an amazing trick. You're actually channeling truth in under these circumstances in Western society. But I've fallen so many times. It's ridiculous. My whole body is battered and bruised in terms of my whole psyche battered and bruised in terms of I keep trying and, you know, can't nail it. Haven't landed it. Almost. You know, not, you know, haven't landed it yet. But we're getting there, aren't we? A lot of turmoil. But what can we do, right? In the world, it's hitting everybody. Everybody around me is in turmoil. It's that just smartness isn't working so well, is it? And they have a meltdown. If smartness doesn't work, they feel, we got no functionality, and then they go into psychosis, psychotic reactions. This is what's happening. It's already happening within those around me, going into psychotic reactions. So, you know, help, Longchenpa. You know, this is a crisis. I'm already feeling the crisis. And well, the real crisis is when the psychotic reactions become very much become fixated on them, as if this is the only way. Then you get real trouble, and that's coming real close now. So I'm under great pressure, under the gun here. Now, will Anandamayama, Sri Sri Anandamayi help out? Bhagavani? Possible. You never know what she's going to do. She's the wild card in the deck, always. The joker. Vajrahari, Hara. Harai, or something like that, Vajrahari or something, there's some term, helped Longchenpa out a lot. Vajrahari, something, that's close, Vajrahari. He was helped out by these, the wild cards called the Dakinis, or the queen of the Dakinis, the wild card, is a wild card who You never know what she's going to do. He's not really a guru. Doesn't have formal students or anything like that. She just sort of an ad hoc, roaming helper. Shows up here, shows up there, kind of like a supervisor of supervisors kind of thing. Sort of, where there's trouble, she shows up to help out a little bit and then disappears, and then shows up somewhere else, disappears. So that definitely is in play. Vajrayogini, Vajradhara, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. That's how that works. Kind of like what was it in USO, was it USO support of armed forces? Bob Hope would go and give shows to the troops. The troops would be given a break, a little short break from all the terrible fighting they're doing, and USO would put on a show for them, a program, entertainment, and Bob Hope would agree to go along, and he would do this comedy routine and laughs and giggles and all that stuff, and the troops would laugh, and he'd pump up their morale by doing that.